This is Blackmagic RAW, the new free compressed RAW technology for acquisition and post from Blackmagic Design.
Cinema 5D at IBC 2018 is brought to you by CVP, your one-stop shop for cine, video, photo, and more. Cartoni supports your vision. Music Vine, beautifully produced music for film and video. And Tilta, arm your camera.
Hi, this is Nino from Cinema 5D. We're here at IBC 2018 at Blackmagic Design with Stuart. Hi, Stuart, how are you?
Yeah, I'm very good, very good.
So, you just released Blackmagic RAW, a RAW codec that is implemented inside your cameras. Can you tell us everything about it?
Yeah, this is actually, I would consider it to be one of our biggest announcements over the last few years. Typically, people are aware with our hardware releases, but you know, to have something that's software-based, codec-based, is really going to make people sit up and listen, I think. For those people that kind of don't really understand codecs or maybe are unfamiliar with RAW, just to give you a very quick overview, I think that the best explanation is that typically a camera will have a codec that it will shoot on to try and harness as much information from the sensor, and that usually is quite large in size. But then when you get to the post side of things, editors are looking for something that's fast and easy to edit with, which means that file sizes need to be small. So what we have been doing over the course of the last 2.5 years is looking at a way in which we can create a codec that can do both. You can take all of the information from the sensor, you can then take that into a post workflow, you can work with that within the editing environment, you can grade that, but also still have the control and functionality of what happened at sensor level all the way through to the point in which you come to deliver.
So how, of course, everybody will ask you this question, how do you compare it to Apple's ProRes RAW? Because it's a similar concept, but you implement it on a camera level, so there's no external recorder needed, is that right?
Yeah, so this is where this product becomes, this codec becomes very, very interesting. So typically what happens is that when you are recording into a codec and you take that into a post environment, there is a demosaicing process, which is taking that and effectively reading that codec to be able to process it. That is all done through through usually GPU or CPU. Now, what happens if you then decided that what we're actually going to do is we're going to do part of that processing within the camera itself? And this is where the idea came up for Blackmagic RAW. What we felt was that if we could get the camera to act as a hardware accelerator for that codec, then we could minimize both the quality and the processing time when we come to post. So what we actually do is we take that demosaicing portion, we actually partially demosaic within the camera, which then means that when it gets into the software, into the editing environment, half of the job is already done. Now, because we're doing that at camera level, we're also working with 12-bit RAW. We're also keeping that as a single file type. But also, when we're bringing that into Resolve, as an example, if we wanted to edit that, we're getting all of the metadata, we're getting all of the camera information, the sensor information, but we're looking at a file size that is considerably smaller than is typically associated to RAW.
Amazing. So what cameras are you going to implement it at start? And I think it's already released, it's out, right?
Yeah, so today at the show we've actually announced the beta products available for people to download who have an URSA Mini 4.6K. That will be the first camera that we implement it in, which means anybody who has a 4.6K camera can go and download that. Our plan is to do the Pocket Cinema camera 4K as well, so it will...
So the 4.6K and the Pro, I guess?
Yeah, so that's going to be all the URSA Mini cameras eventually, but initially to start with just the 4.6K Pro. And then eventually Pocket Cinema camera 4K will also have this too. But it kind of doesn't stop there, because you then got to... One of the things that Blackmagic has always been very pro is it's not about limiting people to use our own proprietary hardware or software. What makes this really flexible is by opening this out to as many people as possible. Anybody who has worked with our hardware in the past knows that we generally have an SDK available on our website for people to integrate with things like our switches and our cameras and so forth. What we've actually done as well today is we've put the SDK for Blackmagic RAW up on the website too. which now means that any software manufacturer can go and download that SDK and start implementing Blackmagic RAW into their own software. So that's completely free of charge, doesn't cost anything, and hopefully harnesses that quality and file size for a number of other software manufacturers.
So hopefully we will see it in a lot of like Premiere Pro, Final Cut 10, hopefully eventually as well.
Yeah, I mean the hope is from our perspective that people see the benefits of working with it, and people integrate that, you know, where they see fit.
Also the cameras, like other manufacturers' cameras, or is it just the software?
So at the moment, it's only within Blackmagic cameras, but we are open to talk to other camera manufacturers as well. You know, I think that if other camera manufacturers feel that it's something that they want to implement, then by all means, you know, we would assist them in that process.
Interesting. Also, you have an external recorder, the video assist. Are there any plans to implement it there as well? Because, of course, that immediately would open it up to a lot of other cameras.
Yeah. Again, I think the starting point is our cameras. You know, we'll see how this develops. The great thing is this is technology that we've developed. It's technology that we own. It's something that we can roll out across, you know, whatever products we see fit. So maybe in the future we'll see, but certainly... right now, it's cameras, DaVinci Resolve.
Okay. And last but not least, let's talk about the software level. So if I install the player, there's a new version of DaVinci Resolve as well, which supports it, where can I use it? Can I use it only in the player and DaVinci Resolve? Is it already possible to encode in it, or is it basically decode?
Okay, so what you have is, when you actually work with Blackmagic RAW, we also provide a Blackmagic player. Now what that is a simple playback tool. So anybody who is working on a standard laptop can load that onto their laptop and see those RAW files immediately.
For both Windows and Mac.
Yes, it's going to be multi-platform. What we're then going to have is that in DaVinci 15.1, which is a new update today, it will have all of the settings in control for Blackmagic RAW. So what you will be able to do is take those RAW files into DaVinci Resolve, manipulate those files, work with those files, go even down as far as changing ISO settings, working within the color spectrums within Blackmagic RAW. But another real key feature for this too is that one of the other things that we're providing with that Blackmagic RAW file is something called a Sidecar file. Now that is a text file that lives in the same folder as the Blackmagic RAW file, and that contains all of the metadata. So when you're actually working with the file, it doesn't matter what you do to that in terms of changing the color, changing the gamma levels, changing the ISO settings, the original RAW file will always be protected. And that sidecar file, which is that text file, will be updated all of the time, every time you make a change. So if I was to actually take that sidecar file and remove it from the folder, when you open that Blackmagic RAW file, you'll see the original film log version, that 12-bit version, log version of that file. So what you could even do is you could even go into that text file and you could actually auto-edit that in a text editor and change ISO settings and change various parameters, and that would automatically update and change the image of that on Blackmagic RAW.
How do the data rates compare to a normal ProRes file, ProRes HQ, let's say?
So we have we have four different constant bitrate file types. That is 3.1, 5.1, 8.1, and 12.1. Those are the varying different compression levels. It's first to state that this is a 12-bit file throughout, whichever one of those that you use. If you're working at 12.1 at Ultra HD, you're talking around about 32 megabits per second. If you're looking at 3.1, you're looking at about 127 megabits per second. If you're, say, looking at that in terms of, well, how much can I get onto a CFast card? On a 256 card, if you're looking at, say, 3.1, you're gonna get around about 23 minutes at Ultra HD. If you're looking at 12.1, you're looking at about 90 minutes.
So that's very, very comparable to what ProRes HQ is, really, which is only 422.
Yeah, exactly. And that's I think, is where people will really start to see the benefit, because you're working at 12-bit, you're working with raw files. That means that you're retaining all the information with all that metadata, plus you're working with a file size that is incredibly small.
Interesting. Well, very amazing product. I hope we see it in a lot of other manufacturers' products implemented as well, as software as well as hardware, other cameras. And yeah, we'll check it out. And thank you, Stuart.
Yeah, thank you.
And yeah, thanks everybody for watching. This is Cinema 5D at IBC 2018, and stay tuned for all our coverage on the site.